Today's episode of Parenting Great Kids is brought to you by March of Dimes. From prematurity to maternal death, the health issues facing families in this country are getting worse. March of Dimes is leading the fight for the health of all moms and babies. We won't stop looking for solutions to improve the lives of families through research, advocacy, and education. Join us at www.marchofdimes.org/Meg. For 30 plus years, I've seen every type of child grow up.
Instead of giving me what I wanted, she gave me what I needed, which was truth.
Don't let emotions win. Let truth win.
Do your very best, and you should have a lot of fun while you do it. And the better you get at something, the more fun you're going to have at something.
You moms and dads are wired with everything you need to be a parent to a great kid. Welcome to Parenting Great Kids. This is episode number 52. I'm your host, Dr. Meg Meeker. Today, we're going to be talking about disciplining children. The common trouble spots that most of us have when it comes to disciplining our kids, whether they're 2 or 12 or even 18. My guests are Rachael Herrscher and Cassi Reece. Rachael Herrscher is the founder of the awesome website todaysmama.com. And Rachael and Cassi both have children, and we're going to have a wonderful discussion talking to them about troubleshooting discipline issues with their kids. We've had a lengthy discussion, so I won't be answering reader questions today, but don't worry. Very soon, I will devote an entire podcast to answering the great questions that you, my audience, have asked me over the past couple of months. As always, I'll share my points to ponder for you to start using right away. And parents, as a reminder, don't just download episodes, click subscribe. When you do that, you're joining my parenting revolution, and every new episode will automatically show up in your subscribed list. You won't regret it, I promise. And we'd love for you to write us a review on iTunes. Let us know what you think. Also, not only are we on iTunes, but the Parenting Great Kids podcast is also available in the Google Play Store and on Stitcher. So no matter where you get your podcasts, subscribe today and don't miss out on a single episode. Now let's get on to my points to ponder. 1. The real goal of disciplining your son or daughter is to teach them self-control. Remember this, friends. No one, you, I, any adult, any friend that you have, even any child or a teenager, no one can be successful at anything if that person doesn't have self-control. Think about it. If you have a good marriage, you have self-control. If you're a good parent, you have self-control. If you're a good employer, you're good at your work, you're a good athlete, if you're good at dieting, whatever it is, in order to be successful, a person has to have self-control. And when you think about it, discipline is all about teaching kids to behave, to talk a certain way, behave a certain way, treat others a certain way, and conduct themselves in a certain way. We're teaching our kids how to behave well and how to take charge of their behavior. So really, teaching self-control is one of the biggest reasons we discipline our kids. And that is one of the principles that I talk about in my Discipline with Courage and Kindness course. When a child is young, he or she can't have good self-control. They're kids. They're very impulsive. They say things without thinking. They do things without thinking. They're children. So the beginning of teaching kids self-control is with a small child, you need to impose control on your kids so they learn what it's like to live with boundaries and rules. And as they learn to see the benefits of having boundaries and having limits and rules, they learn as they mature to impose those rules on themselves. And that's a very important skill. And that a lot of that begins during pre-adolescence and adolescent period, particularly during those teen years. That's a time when kids learn to go from having rules imposed on them to imposing rules on themselves. But there's a whole process that has to take place there in order for kids to learn self-control. Point to ponder number 2, parents, please, and I say this a lot, Trust your instincts, particularly when it comes to disciplining your kids. Most parents, if I sit down and have a heart-to-heart with them, know what they want to discipline their kids for. They know what they want the rules to be. Countless times I've had conversations with mothers or fathers that go something like this. Dr. Meeker, I really don't want my 10-year-old to have a cell phone, but I'm afraid if I don't give her a cell phone, she's going to become alienated from me, she's going to not like me, she's going to throw fits, or she's going to feel on the outs with her friends. And then they say, so what should I do? To which I say, you just told me what you want. You don't want your 10-year-old to have a cell phone. So act on your instinct and don't give her a cell phone. Have the strength to do what you know is good and best for your child. And I promise you, friends, if you act on your instincts, you implement the rules you believe are best and good and right for your kids, you will never regret it. When it comes to what to discipline for and what the rules of your house should be, trust your instincts. 3. And you'll hear Cassie and Rachel and I talk about this, particularly true for mothers, but fathers as well. Lean on your tribe. Lean on your tribe. When you are struggling with any kind of parenting issue with your kids, particularly when it comes to discipline issues, it's very important that you have older women or older men that you admire, that you can go to and that you trust and ask for help. So, for instance, if you have a friend who has kids that are 5 or 6 or 7 years older than your kids, and you like the way her kids are behaving, and you ascribe to the way she's parenting, and you think she's doing a good job, or he, if it's a dad, you go to that mother or father. I encourage moms to go to the mom and dad to go to the dad and say, you know what? I'm struggling with Johnny. I can't get Johnny to stop back talking to me, or I can't get Susie to listen to me when I tell her to do the chores. And I've watched you parent. What would you recommend? Go to a friend who you know is not going to come down on you, is not going to judge you, who's going to have your back, who's going to believe in you and a parent, who's going to encourage you, and who's going to give you sound, sage advice. It's really important to learn to lean on your tribe, because when all is said and done, family can be there for us, but oftentimes things, particularly when it comes to parenting issues, can be a little sticky with family. So it's really important to have some trusted friends. You don't need a lot, you know, 1 or 2 or 3 good friends that have older kids that you can go to and say, please help me out. I really need some help here. It's really important to moms, and we'll talk about this with Cassie and Rachel, that we not compare our parenting to our friends' parenting. We all tell ourselves stories about what we should be doing and how our kids should behave and how we're not doing it well enough. Stop that. We need to change the internal dialogue. And one of the best ways that we do that is to stop comparing ourselves to how our friends are parenting. I'm really excited today to be talking with Rachel and Cassie because I just finished my new course called Discipline with Courage and Kindness. It's available at MegMeekerMD.com. Check it out. I think you're going to love it. I discuss 4 principles to good and effective discipline for any child, whether they're 2, 10, or 17. And I strongly encourage you to take a look at this course after you listen to the podcast, because we're going to be talking about discipline. So friends, thanks for listening. This is episode number 52. Stay with us. I want you to now listen in on a conversation that I had with Rachel and Cassie. I know you're really going to enjoy this one. So Rachel and Cassie, thank you so much for joining me on the podcast today to talk about discipline, parenting, mom stuff, work stuff, trouble with our kids, frustrations with our kids. Really appreciate you guys coming on.
Thank you.
Yeah, we're excited.
Good. So, Rachel, you have 3 kids, a little older than Cassie's. Your kids are 15, 14, and 9. And Cassie, you're in the 4 kid club like I am, one of the crazy ladies who doesn't mind chaos. And your kids are 7, 5, 2, and 8 months. So this is really great that we have such a wide age range of kids that we're going to be talking about. And specifically, I really want to pick you gals' brains about discipline issues with your kids. So, Rachel, let's start with you. You're in the throes of the teen years.
Yes.
And you've got a grade schooler. So with your kids, what do you find over the years have been the biggest challenges you've had in disciplining your kids?
I would say follow through, because that's on me, right? Sometimes, you know, you're ready to lay down the hammer and it's too much work, or frankly, you forget that you're like, oh yeah, you were grounded from the TV or whatever. Right. And then it slips through the cracks. So follow through has always been at the forefront of my mind since they were like toddlers to now. But I would say now with teenagers, really, I'm like, teenage girls, man, can we just talk about that? I know I was one.
I know. You kind of wonder what is going on inside their minds. And it's my sister said it's kind of like akin to going into a dangerous neighborhood by yourself. You want to enter, but you're afraid of what you're going to find when you get into their minds and in their thoughts. You know, it's a little scary in there, but they do. I mean, they live sort of in a world that feels very disconnected to you. But I love your honesty in saying that follow through is really the toughest part, because I think, quite honestly, a lot of that falls on mom's shoulders, because we're the ones that usually spend more time with our kids than dads do. Yeah. So we're the ones who say, no, you can't use your phone today. Remember, I grounded you from your phone a couple days ago. Or we're the ones who, like what happened to me when my daughter was 13 and I grounded her for a whole month because she told me to shut up, and that's like no go in our home.
Yes.
She was mad. She was hormonal. I was hormonal. We were fighting and she'd had enough. But in a way, when we discipline our kids, it costs us a lot, because when I grounded her, that meant I had to be home with her after school every day for a month while she wasn't at basketball practice or wherever she was supposed to be. So discipline is kind of miserable for us, and it requires a lot of energy. So what do you do to kind of help yourself follow through with the consequences you've given your kids? Have you found any tricks, or is it just a function of energy for you?
It's really both. There's the part that is a function of energy and me just like not walking away and not thinking about it again. I do have to make sure that I tell my husband, all right, here's where we're at. Here's what I did. And he has to do the same thing with me, so we're on the same page, because if I haven't like fully briefed him on what that consequence is or whatever's going to happen, right, then my kids can catch him off guard. Like,
oh yeah. Oh, they will.
Yeah. They try to play that game where they go between the two. And honestly, sometimes they're going to catch us in it where we're both not on the same page because we don't know. But so that's one of the biggest things, I think, is my husband and I being on the same page so that we're like bringing down the same power of the law.
Yeah. Well, you have to have a united front. Because kids are tough, and the nicest, kindest, sweetest kids can be so stubborn and so conniving when it comes to getting out of the consequences to their behavior and trying to manipulate one parent and get their way. It can be really, really hard. Typically with your teenagers, what kind of consequences do you find for bad behavior? Do you find really work for them? Is it different for each of your kids?
Yeah, I'll tell you one of the things that universally, it's the big focus at my house, and I call them I statements, and I'm sure I didn't invent these, but when my kids come to me or when something's going on, they're fighting or whatever's happening, they are not allowed to speak by saying he or she. They have to say I. And I just keep saying, I fill in the blank. We'll get to the rest of the details after. I just need to know exactly what you did, because other than that, you spend all this time trying to draw out everybody's real part. If I can start in reverse, right? Because kids will just kill it to the end until they'll admit their role in the situation.
Oh, yeah.
If I can get them to tell me their role up front, then I can get to the when, whys, and hows after. So, like, there was one time when my oldest son, he and the 15-year-old and the 14-year-old, it was a couple years ago, were having a total meltdown together. And they had to use their I statements, and you really can't run from them. So my son Josh said, I, and I'm like, yep, fill in the blank. He said, sprayed Febreze in her face.
That's not funny, but he said it.
And you know why? He also started laughing because how can you defend yourself once you've really said, I fill in the blank, like I sprayed Febreze in her face. Right? And so it's just total accountability up front. And then she said something like, you know, I told them to shut up. She had told them something like stupid, right? But that clearly did not deserve Febreze in the face. But, you know, so if I can get them to own their stuff up front, that just makes my job so much easier. But I think it helps, hopefully it's helping to raise some accountable kids who are comfortable owning what they did.
That is brilliant. That is brilliant.
Oh, thank you.
I have practiced pediatrics a little over 30 years now. I have never heard of a parent doing that. It is brilliant because it diffuses all of the nonsense and the sort of jimmy rigging of an argument to sort of say, to point the finger, to dance around the real issue was, okay, what did you do? Because also when you get a child to admit, I did this, then you're not the bad guy coming and saying, well, you know what? Okay, that puts me as your mom in a tough situation because now I need to give you a consequence for spraying Febreze because you just can't do that. Right?
No. And when you say it out loud.
Yeah. And there's nowhere they can go.
Yeah. And you also have to be, as a parent, a safe place to say those things. Right?
Yes.
And so you have to be the parent that's not just going to lose your stuff because you sprayed Febreze in her face. I mean,
right.
I've said this before, I think in conversations we've had, is your house has to be a safe place to make mistakes. I read it somewhere that if you don't make your home the place that's safe for your kids to make mistakes, they have to go make their mistakes outside your home.
And that's dangerous. Yeah.
Yeah. Where would you rather have them make them? Right. And so when you say I sprayed Febreze in her face and, you know, I can't remember what the consequence was. It was a good one. You know, you just kind of have to accept it.
Absolutely. And I think that's so smart, you know, and fundamentally, if you really sort of pare things down, there's three parenting styles or three discipline styles: authoritative, authoritarian, and permissive. And really authoritative is what you're shooting for. Authoritarian is dad comes home, slams his fist on the table. I'm going to give you something to really cry about. Will not hear the kids. Terrifying figure in the home. Versus the permissive parent who's like, okay, anything goes. And well, you know, if you felt you needed to do that because you were frustrated and that's what you had to do is act on your frustration and spray Febreze in your sister's face, you know, okay. But the authoritative is the one that says, you know what? Mom and dad are in charge and we have rules of conduct in our home because we live by rules of conduct because that's how you function in life. You know,
yeah.
All have to have that. So you have to be accountable. I love that, the I statement. Cassi, have you ever tried anything like that with your kids? Your kids are younger, you know, 7 down to 8 months of age. What do you find are your biggest challenges in disciplining your young kids?
Oh, well, first of all, I'm taking notes on everything you both are saying. you'll quickly see that Rachel is definitely a more experienced mom, and I'm kind of in the trenches of learning the how-tos of motherhood.
That's the nice way of calling me the old mom.
Experience, yeah, go ahead.
Well, and with that experience, I've read Rachel's advice on the I statements before on her blog, and I need to readdress that in my home, bring it back in, because I have tried that before, and I have found success with that. And then I kind of forgot it existed, you know? So I need to restart
that.
Well,
and let me tell you, not to cut you off, but I'm totally cutting you off. Sometimes it takes a while. Like sometimes you'll ask yourself, oh my gosh, this was not simple, because I will have to over and over again say, nope, start over. I fill in the blank. I can't tell you how many times I say, I fill in the blank until they're so frustrated that they will just, I fill in the blank. Right. And so that takes time and patience on our part too. So it's not necessarily the quickest thing. Like you got to be ready for a whole conversation.
Which is the follow through. And I feel like that's probably one of the gems. If you can start that early, the follow through, and get yourself into practice and have your kids know that you're a mom that's going to follow through. I'm already starting that with my 2-year-old. I mean, really kind of my baby even, you know, with his sleep habits and things like that, you know, kind of structuring that. But right now I've kind of entered the dreaded taking away the binky with my 2-year-old. And I have to just stick with it. And it's going to be awful for probably about a week.
Yeah.
And my husband's going to sleep downstairs with earplugs and, you know, I'll be able to hash it out in the middle of the night. But if I can follow through on that, that's kind of one that I'm working on and have found success with my two olders who are binky free, you know, hopefully at 7 and 5, they're binky free. But I mean, other follow through things that I'm trying to, that's kind of the underlying theme of my life right now. You know, I have my daughter is in violin. She's 7 and she can whine and complain and hate it because it's hard. Doesn't necessarily hate the instrument, just doesn't enjoy working hard and practicing. So the follow through on that. Mm-hmm. And my son is probably just in the mid of learning how to enjoy helping out at home, you know, picking up after himself or, you know, heaven forbid, doing a chore and following through and being consistent each day with helping him learn why we help out in the house and what a difference it makes for the other people because he's not the only one, you know, who lives here. And how to motivate. So those are kind of my big enchiladas right now in the trenches of early learning.
What I love about what you're both saying is this is sort of a family issue. It's a family function. You know, you've got different kids in different ages and different stages who are all sort of going through the same thing. It's like, wait a minute, we all have rules we have to follow. We all have to participate in this. We all have to use our I statements. And I think as hard as that is, that really binds the family together. And I'm a big believer in kids doing chores and following through because kids need a sense of belonging. And although they whine about doing stuff, their self-esteem grows so much when they contribute to the family unit, to the family functioning. And even sort of abiding by the same family rules, you know, you won't hear it when they're young, but eventually they sort of wear that as a badge of honor. You know, this is what we had to do.
Yes.
Boy, my mom made us work and my mom made me, you know, play the violin 18 hours a day. And, you know, but they kind of wear it.
I have those stories.
Yeah, but they kind of wear it as a badge of honor because they were asked to do something because you saw them, you engaged them, you pulled them in, you said, you matter. And your behavior matters and what you do matters. And I think the kids who are ignored and not paid attention to and not really sort of assertively, I don't want to say aggressively, but assertively, intentionally parented feel very sort of empty. Like, who do I belong to and what do I do? And so I think as hard as what you're all talking about doing is, it's so fundamental to building a great sense of identity in your kids because they're functioning as a big unit. And that's where I think it's really, really important. I often hear this statement from parents, and I would love your take on it, and then I'll sort of give you my answer, but I'd love to hear your answer. I often hear from very frustrated, tired mothers, I have a 10-year-old. I've tried to discipline. I've tried everything to get him to listen to me. Nothing works. Discipline doesn't work. He doesn't care. He doesn't pay attention. So I give up. What should I do? And I'm sure there are times where you as moms have felt with your kids, what you're doing isn't working and you just sort of want to throw in the towel. How do you respond when you're feeling that way or when you see a friend or you hear that from another mother? I've tried everything. Nothing works. What does that say to you gals?
Well, Rachel, you want me to take this one first?
Yeah, Cassie, you go first.
Well, one thing that I do try to do is kind of surround myself with women who have been there, done that before, and talk with them. So Rachel is a great resource in talking with you, Meg, also, and other friends, family members, neighbors who have older children who have lived through it and can say, you know, that listening ear, I understand, and give their tips or their feedback to kind of help us build and grow together as a community of women and mothers that is all around us. So that's one thing I try to do.
Our tribe. Got to have our tribe.
Yes, our tribe. Exactly.
Got to have our tribe. Rachel?
I mean, for me, and this may sound like the really aggressive parent, but I'm saying to myself, oh man, you haven't found your kid's pain point yet. Like, which comes back down to follow through, right? It's like when my kids get certain consequences taken away and I stick to it, they're desperate to earn their life back, right?
Yeah.
Or whatever it is that they're missing. You know, like when I was little, my son who's 15, you know, he had such a temper and I thought, oh my gosh, he's going to grow up and like rove the streets with brass knuckles, starting fights.
The jail. He's ending up in jail.
He's going to burn the city down. There was even one time where he just grabbed my face and he said, you're not the big boss of me. I'm the big boss. And I was like, oh my gosh, he's crazy.
Exactly.
You know, but we'd go to Sunday dinner at my mother-in-law's and without fail, every time he'd get in a fist fight with his cousin, you know, I mean, toddler fist fight, whatever. Yeah. Like he'd just have meltdown after meltdown. So his consequence became, all right, you don't get to be at family dinner anymore. You know, we'll go sit in the car. And if you still can't pull it together, we'll drive home. That was super inconvenient for me.
Oh yeah.
And it really broke his heart, right? Like, oh my gosh, I just got pulled out of the party. But guess what? It stopped it.
Like, it worked.
It stopped his behavior because I just said, hey, you want to go home? And he's like, oh man, she means business. No, I will pull it together, you know? And so that, it was a pain point for both of us. But again, like it takes time.
I think you're absolutely right. And one of the things when I hear parents say that, because I get that a lot and I totally get it, is that every child has an Achilles heel. Every child has a pain point. And it's very different for every child. You know, some kids you look at the wrong way. You give a firm look and they melt.
I've got one of those too.
Other kids come at you and go, just let's give it a go, mom. Just let's give it a go. You can't do anything to me that's going to bother me. But that child may need to be taken out of sports. But every child has a pain point and Achilles heel, and every parent needs to find it and use it. And it sounds cruel as we sit here talking, but consequences have to be bad enough that kids are motivated to avoid them.
Yeah.
If kids don't care about the consequence, it's no big deal. Or they know that mom's going to say, you can't join the family meal, let you sit in the car for 10 minutes, feel so guilty that you're not at the family meal that she pulls you back in, of course it's not going to work. So I think a lot of it is, you're absolutely right, Rachel. You don't find the pain point, or you don't use the pain point, and you don't have the sort of emotional fortitude to withstand your child's punishment.
Yeah.
Because a lot of mothers feel so guilty giving consequences that harm their children. We're not talking about physically harming. You know, we're all on the same page here. Making our kids so uncomfortable with a consequence that they want to avoid them the next go round. And I think that that's hard, particularly for single mothers who really don't want conflict with their kids because they're just trying to get through the day. Cassi, what do you think about when you hear that, gee whiz, I've tried everything and nothing works? What comes to mind for you?
Oh, man, it kind of makes me want to take a nap. Sounds exhausting.
Yes.
But I am kind of taking note of what you said earlier, that the follow through is really saying you matter.
Yeah.
And if we can hold on to that and continue to try to follow through, you know, it could take months, years, even for some kids, depending on their personality and your personality and how you work together. But I'm also, you know, not a very, I don't want to quit, you know, so I hope that I can become an empowered mom and more as the years go by to just keep at it. You know, that's kind of what comes to mind is you can do it, and put up quotes or reminders or scriptures or whatever you need around your house to remind you that if you keep trying, it will hopefully begin to work. And again, reach out to those that are your support system and, you know, gain encouragement. But you were made for this and you can do it.
One of the things too is I still think we can wrap discipline up with a bow and all leave having a really good experience. So like, again, this all goes back to time. So we have to be willing to spend the time. Like when my little boy was losing his mind all the time, right? I had to realize, okay, buddy, we're having a hard time managing our temper. So my job then is to also give him tools or teach him how to communicate or help him get a handle on it, right? Not just send him to time out, but then I've got to circle back and be like, okay, you know, next time he takes your toy, what can you do instead of hit him? Like, let's try to give you skills,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
along the way too, and end it with a conversation and a hug and whatever. And that to me is for at a toddler level or at a teenage level.
You know, I love, well, first of all, Cassie, I love what you said when you said, you know, it may not work for months or it may take months, because a lot of times we'll find a really good strategy or a really good consequence for bad behavior and we'll do it for a month or two. And if we don't see improvement in our kids, we give up. But the truth of the matter is sometimes you need to take a great strategy and you need to work it for years. And because behavior change, and we're really talking about breaking bad habits, is what our job as moms is. I'm going to break the bad habit you have of being mean to your sister. I'm going to break the bad habit you have of not wanting to follow through, not do your chores, losing your temper or whatever. So I think that we need to give it time, because really good discipline and behavior change takes years in some kids. And, you know, one of my favorite things that I have found myself saying to a number of the patients I've worked with over the years is, your goal as a mom or dad is to raise a great 25-year-old. And if your 16-year-old is giving you fits, here's the good news, bad news. You've got 9 years to help them correct their behavior, but that's the good news. But the bad news, it's 9 years. And you need some brain development along the way in them that will really help you out. And then what you were talking about, Rachel, you know, I just finished a course. I'm really excited about discipline with courage and kindness. And I map out four principles to really good, solid, healthy, effective discipline. And one of them is teaching self-control, because teaching our kids self-control is really the real goal of discipline, because you can't be successful in anything in life, relationships, work, a skill, a hobby, anything, if you don't have self-control. And so really what you're talking about doing is coming to your kids and saying, you're out of control in this one area of your life, your temper, your behavior, the way you speak, whatever it is.
How much screen time? That's the big teenager thing, right?
Yeah, screen time, social media, video games. And so if you depersonalize the behavior and you go to your son and you say, you know what, I'm really concerned because you've developed a habit of wanting to play video games 4 hours every afternoon. And you and I both know that's not really healthy for you. So how can I, as your mom, help you break this habit? So you sort of say, okay, let's team up here and let's help you break this habit. And in order to get your child to assume responsibility and control, A, they can't really fully do that till they're well into their teens. I mean, you can't ask a 5-year-old to fully control their behavior. You impose the control, you impose the rules, you act like the mean bad guy and say, here are the parameters. And then you help them see what it's like to live with those parameters, i.e., you get half hour a day or whatever. And then as they get older, they can learn to impose those controls on themselves. Like, okay, I'm 15. I'm playing 5 hours of video games a day. This is not good for me. And even though you tell that to your 15-year-old, they hate it. They scream, they yell. Deep down, they know you're right. So, okay, how are we going to do this? And because it's a bad habit, I, unfortunately, as your mom, have to implement consequences to you doing that. But I need your help there. So it's that whole idea of that training of the inner person, the training of that deep part of your child that needs self-control. And I think if you sort of depersonalize that and understand what you're really doing and giving your kids, you can be all in. And you can go, this is exhausting. I can't stand it. It's uncomfortable. But if you really try to make it less emotional, I think it really is a lot easier. But I think a lot of times moms get really tangled and we get pulled into this emotional sort of ping-ponging back and forth with our kids and we get sort of dragged down and we start to feel like, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on this because I know you both work at Today's Mama, which is an awesome site for moms. So you hear from a lot of moms that discipline is really emotionally charged for a lot of mothers. And I think sometimes we see our kids behaving really badly and we start to feel like, well, what's wrong with my parenting? Surely my friends' kids would never do this. Talk to that. Talk about why it's so emotional for us mothers in our discipline.
I think women are creatures of guilt.
Yeah.
Like, we make ourselves feel guilty about everything.
We do.
You know, and by nature and my personality, sometimes I fall in that trap, but I think it's my personality that I don't often. Like, I kind of am happy to be like, well, maybe I set lower expectations so I don't have disappointment, right? Like, if there's a scuffle on the playground, I'm first going to assume my kid's involved, right? And I'm not going to feel bad about it. Like, you know, kids are kids or whatever it is, and kind of get in there and see what our role is and then back out of it and do my part, hopefully, most of the time. But sometimes you do feel guilty, right? Like, I haven't put enough time in this or this or this. And then you just have to back it up and be like, but this is my family. These are my people. These are individual circumstances, you know, and we don't work the same way as everybody else.
No.
So I think that's probably a first place to start, is just like dealing with the guilt piece and moving on.
Right. And sometimes saying, wait a minute, maybe my child's acting this way because that's who they are. You know, kids are born with all these different personalities. And I finally, it was so freeing to me when my kids hit their 20s. They come to you and they give you the list of all the things you did wrong. And you're like, okay, thank you very much. That was fun. Now you're a grown up. What's your part in all of this? And to realize some kids are a lot harder to parent than other kids. Some kids are by nature really compliant. Some kids are really strong-willed. I love strong-willed kids because these are the kids are going somewhere. You know, the kids that you're afraid that it's either jail or they're going to be president. What's it going to be? And guess what? It's not all on your shoulders, mom. You know, your job is to sort of bend them in this direction and bend them that, not to overhaul their personality. You know, they come out the way they are.
Yeah. Do you think we overestimate our role in
yes.
who they are?
Yes. Well, yeah. If they make mistakes, we feel fully responsible for all their mistakes. And on the flip side, if our kids are successful, we don't always feel responsible for their successes. So I think mothers tend to tip the balance, and that's not right. But you're absolutely right. I think we're given these kids who have these amazing personalities, and our job is to sort of blunt the edges of the bad habits and the bad personality and sort of take the good that's in there and grow it. And we do the best we can. And the truth of the matter is, as long as we get the big stuff right, that's all our kids need. We put way too much on ourselves. And there's a lot of the personality that's just going to sort of be what it is. And we're there to help them navigate along the way and be better at the good stuff, blunt the bad stuff, and let them fly. But I think we put way too much on ourselves. Yeah.
Well, and you know, there was a time where, so my middle, she's 14 now. She has been the chattiest thing her whole life. Cassi, I think you can attest to this. You know Addie.
Love her.
And it's hilarious because she has the nickname Chatty Addie. I mean, I would put her to bed at night and she would just say, guess what?
Oh,
guess
yeah.
Guess what? Until she had until you could see the wheels in her head spinning, trying to think of just another story to tell me. I would have to like sneak out of her room. And I felt guilty. I felt like, oh my gosh, I'm giving her abandonment issues. Like, we do this whole thing, right? Like, I'm going to give her abandonment issues. Maybe she doesn't feel like she gets enough attention. That's why she talks so much. But guess what? At the end of the day, I just think there's like a hamster running on a wheel in
yes.
her brain.
That's it.
And that's who she is. And that's it's okay. We just all have to figure out how to like deal with the volume, you know?
Exactly. Parents, I hope you're enjoying my conversation with Rachael and Cassi. We need to take a quick break, but don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more of my conversation with these delightful moms. Friends, spring is here, and that means spring cleaning is too. The Magic Eraser is great at cleaning tough messes all around your house. I believe it's going to be the most useful tool in your spring cleaning toolbox this year. All you have to do is wet, squeeze, and erase. It cleans messes and stains where wipes and sprays fail. And I love the Magic Eraser because there are no nasty odors that you have to inhale. The new Magic Eraser is made with Durafoam to last longer. And when the season changes from winter to spring and you're trying to do that heavy house cleaning, You really need to try Mr. Clean's Magic Eraser. It helps with your kitchen, bathroom, marks on the walls, even scuffs on white sneakers. And you know in the kitchen when you have those burnt on stains on the stovetop? The Mr. Clean's Magic Eraser works beautifully on those. It takes off baked on grease, microwave splatter, and those mystery spills that you get inside your fridge. It's especially good in your bathroom to get away that grimy soap scum that you get in your sinks and around your bathtub. And even if you have little ones at home, those scuff marks and crayon marks on walls, Mr. Clean Magic Eraser takes off those too. I encourage all of my listeners to try the Mr. Clean Magic Eraser. You can get a list of stains and messes that it takes off at www.mrclean.com/parentinggreatkids. What moms out there can relate to the frustration of feeling like you're constantly replacing the items that you send to daycare and school with your kids? Mabel's Labels, stylish, durable labels are the perfect solution for all the stuff that kids lose. Finally, say goodbye to costly replacements and germy mix-ups. Simply personalize your labels online and they'll get shipped for free right to your door, ready to peel and stick on all your bottles, clothing, lunch boxes, and more. And because they're laundry and dishwasher safe and available in so many fun colors and designs, they're sure to become your new household must-have. Visit mabelslabels.com/greatkids today to start customizing your own. And if you use the code GREATKIDS, all caps, you'll get 20% off your next order. Again, that's mabelslabels.com/greatkids and promo code GREATKIDS for 20% off your next order. Friends, the fact is, taking care of your health is a commitment, and sometimes that can feel overwhelming. That's why I've been loving Omax 3 Ultra Pure Supplements. With Omax 3, you just need to do one little thing to experience big health benefits. Omax 3 Ultra Pure is the purest omega-3 supplement on the market, containing nearly 94% high-quality omega-3s. They even do this cool thing called the freezer test challenge. If you freeze any other omega-3 supplement, it'll get cloudy. That's all the filler. But an Omax 3 soft gel remains clear. It's that pure. Better yet, omega-3s are amazing at alleviating joint pain and muscle soreness and making you feel your best post-workout. They can also improve focus and memory, boost cardiovascular health, and more. It just makes sense to take a daily omega-3 supplement. Try it for yourself. Omax 3 comes with a 60-day money-back guarantee, so you have plenty of time to really feel the Omax difference. Go to tryomax.com/meg today to get a box of Omax 3 Ultra Pure for free. That's tryomax.com/meg to get your free box of Omax 3. tryomax.com/meg. Terms and conditions apply. Cassi, do you find yourself sort of reading your kids and going, uh-oh, they're doing that because I'm not this or I'm messing up here or there?
Oh, absolutely. Especially because at this younger age, you really do feel almost like they're mini you.
Yes.
Little yous running everywhere. And so, you know, we're at this stage with a lot of my younger kids where I'm still meeting up with other moms at play dates, or we are spending a lot of time at grandparents' house during the day because we can, and not all my children are in school yet. And so I do find myself wondering if people are judging me, if one of them misbehaves or is naughty or does something that, you know, I wouldn't prefer for them to do, but they made the choice to do it, even at these young ages. So I do have to work through that. I'm kind of still at the point where I'm not completely sure how. Mm-hmm. You kind of have to just get over it and do your thing. But I do enjoy a good heart-to-heart with friends or family when we can really see that not anyone is perfect. And we all have something we're going through. You know, it could be more intense at some points and more relaxed at others. But no child is perfect. And it's helpful to, again, to turn to your tribe and people that you trust where you can really open up your heart and vent or be vented to and, you know, release some of that that pressure and guilt.
And I think a lot of the guilt comes from the stories we tell ourselves in our mind. And I think that when we go to play groups and we feel that other mothers are judging our kids' behavior, the reason that really bothers us is because we really believe the stories we tell ourselves, which are, yeah, you know, I'm really not that good. And yeah, my child really is talking too much or acting out or whatever because of my parenting. But we can do something about those messages because those aren't true. And we need to start talking to ourselves and sort of saying, you know what? I am a good mom. I'm with my kids. I'm present with my kids. I love my kids like crazy. I work hard to discipline them well. I work hard at a handful of things to be a good mom. There's a whole laundry list of things I don't do, and that's perfectly okay. And, you know, one of the greatest lines an older mother, one of my colleagues is about 10 years older than I, so her kids were a little bit older. And when her daughter was 16, she is Caucasian. My friend's Caucasian. And she adopted two African-American kids and had one of her own. And her African-American daughter, when she was 16, found another African-American boyfriend who's significantly older than she and got pregnant. And my girlfriend was a fabulous mom. I mean, this mom was she was an open book. She talked about everything. She helped her daughter find her birth parents, everything. Really honored her African-American mm-hmm. heritage. And she was beside herself when her 16-year-old got pregnant. And she said, what have I done as a mom that this would happen? My daughter and I, we talk about everything. We communicate so well. And she said, one day I went on the beach and I was walking along the beach, and she has a strong faith in God. And she said, and all of a sudden, it's like this voice said to me, guess what? I'm God and I'm the perfect parent. And look how many messed up kids I have.
Yes.
And she goes, whoa. She goes, and I'm an imperfect parent. Maybe my 16-year-old daughter got pregnant and it didn't have anything to do with me. Maybe I am a really good mom and this was just something she did. And she said it was so freeing. And I loved that. I thought, you know what? Why can't we all treat ourselves like that as moms and give ourselves a pass and say, here are five things that I do really well as a mom, and I'm going to let the rest go. And you know what? If I feed my kids McDonald's once a week, oh, well, it doesn't mean they're going to not go to college because they don't have adequate brain development or whatever, you know? The stories we tell yes. ourselves are so out of whack.
Well, and I have to go back to something you said because it's something I've been thinking about a ton. And I think comes more with teenagers, and this will be the thing that I've got to let go of into their adulthood is, what if they have their own lives?
Yes. Right?
What if they have their own set of things that they need to learn as like little humans that actually have absolutely nothing to do with me and their own personal path? Like, that's crazy.
Absolutely. And you can't wear their guilt. And the other thing you learn when your kids hit 20s is all the stuff they did during the teen years that you didn't know about. And I was so glad I didn't know about it. You guys are on the front end of that.
It's coming.
But just to realize, you know what? That's going to happen, but you're going to have their back. And I always told my kids, and I think I told you gals this one time, I used to have a core group of moms. So we were sort of the mom squad when our kids were teenagers. We all had the same rules about dating and television, cell phones, and all this kind of stuff. And we all made it a point to get to know each other's kids. And these were kids who were my kids' friends. Okay, so that worked really well. And we all had similar kind of rules, so we weren't always just the bad, geeky, controlling mom in the group, okay, who said it's not okay to have sex when you're 15. So we all ascribed to this. But we also told each of those kids, if at any point in time you're in a bad situation and you're afraid to call your mom or dad, you call me and I will pick you up, no questions asked, wherever you are. Do not get in a car, because we had an incident many years ago where kids got in a car. A girl was at a party. Everybody was getting drunk and she called home. Nobody answered the phone, left a message, got in the car with a drunk kid and died on the way home. So we said, this will never happen to our children. So we didn't sanction our kids doing bad stuff, but we said, look, life is hard when you're 16 or 17 or 18. We're going to have your back. This is where we want you to go. And we have high expectations for your behavior. But if you're ever ever in trouble, you count on one of these four moms. And I will tell you, we're still close with all those kids. And those kids, a couple of them went off to college and they called me and had questions about different kind of really personal stuff. And it was really, really cool. So I think that there are many ways we can use our mini tribes and our bigger tribes to help our kids.
I love that. It's not only just for us, kind of how I've been, you know, referring to it. It's for our kids' protection and support as well. I love that.
And to know, and I'll tell you, and my kids in their adult years said they loved knowing my friends and my husband's friends and knowing that they held similar values for what we expected of them and what we wanted of them, because that gave them a real sense of security. I'll never forget my son. I was driving my son back to college one year and we were talking and he said, "So what are you doing tonight?" And I said, "I'm going to give a talk to some parents about parenting." And he said, "What are you going to say?" And I said, "Well, before I answer that, what do you think I should say?" And he was 19. He goes, "Mom, that is so easy. Just tell him to behave." I said, "What?" And he said, "Mom, one of the biggest issues kids have is when their parents act more like kids than the kids do. When the parents want to dress like the kids, talk like the kids, act like the kids, and serve alcohol to all the kids."
Yes.
And I was like, wow, out of the mouth of babes. And so to him, he wore it as a badge of honor that my husband and I didn't ascribe to any of that. You know, we expect you when you're in high school not to drink. So you're not going to drink at our house. If you're at somebody else's house and people are drinking and you need to be picked up, absolutely we'll pick you up. And absolutely we're not going to get mad at you, because this is a safe house, but we're still going to treat you well. And kids, if you set a bar, kids live up to that bar or down to that bar. And what he was telling me is too many parents hold the bar too low for their kids and kids go there. So I hope that encourages you who have kids who aren't teens yet or older teens yet.
I'm going to raise the bar even higher.
Good.
Just for some safety, just for some cushion.
Cushion. Yeah. And you can always say, and I know this crazy, crazy pediatrician lady who says this and this and this, and it works. So yeah. I'm going to give it a try. Pin it on me. Pin it on anybody else. You know, we only have a couple of minutes left. You've been very, very gracious with your time, but I know one of the hot button issues that you gals have talked about before, because we're really talking about discipline and issues with kids, is kids and phones and technology and social media. And I know that you both hear from a lot of moms at Today's Mama about what they should do with technology. Is that right? Is that a big issue for a lot of parents?
Yeah. And, you know, this is a big issue that I actually write about a lot and focus on a lot, you know, and I may be a little strict on it, but to me, universally, all the research that's coming back says, hey, this is no good for their brains. We're seeing anxiety, depression, and suicide right through the roof. It spikes with smartphone usage, and it doesn't come back down until after they're 18. Yep. And for me, what that says is this is not good for their brains or their brain development until after they're 18. So does that mean my kids aren't on social media at all? No, but it does mean that they've got one platform. My kids, you know, they've chosen Instagram. It's located, their access to it is on my phone.
Good.
That's where they can log in and out, and I have access to everything that happens there. And here's the thing. At first, I let them have it on their phone, and they were spending way too much time. And I had one of those, like, breakdown moments where I'm like, all right, no technology for anybody. We got to reorganize. Once I put their Instagram access on my own phone, they both said to me separately, like, Mom, I'm really glad you did that. I use my time better. I don't miss it. And I mean, honestly, guess how much my two kids, 14 and 15, how many times a month they check Instagram now?
Wow.
Lucky if it's once a week.
Applause.
Because we're handing them heroin and cocaine and saying, you know what, just snort a line a day.
Yeah, exactly.
It's cool. You got this. you know, it's built to be addictive. And so you get it out of their system and they actually notice that they're happier and better for it.
You're absolutely right. And I am seeing in my medical practice, my private practice, exactly what you're describing about Rachel. So I'm so grateful that you talk about the studies there because they're very, very clear. Social media, particularly for girls, because girls, it's social media, and guys, it's usually violent video games or pornography, which is very, very, very prevalent. It doesn't matter what the personality type or whatever. All of these things are highly addictive. And kids want to be in charge. They want to have control, but their brains aren't mature enough to do it. And then parents come along and say, well, I don't want to take control of it because that's mean to my child. They won't trust me. It's not an issue of meanness or anything. Again, it's that principle, the way of discipline, the way to teach your child self-control is to impose that control, make rules. Every parent should have full access to everything they watch, say, yes, hear on television, Instagram, social media, period. It's not a trust issue. Parents got to get over that. It's a safety issue. Because a lot transpires, and when a child has a parent take charge and say, here are the rules with social media, here are the rules with video games, here are the rules with phone usage. We have a basket in our kitchen, and between the hours of 7 and 8 or 6 and 8 or whatever, all electronics are in this basket, including mine, because that's the way our family functions. The kids feel so much better. I have never had a child come to me and say, I regret so much that my mom or dad took social media or video games away from me. Now, in the days following putting the hammer down with the rules, yes, kids are going to complain. But a month, two, three, a year later, every single patient has said, I am so glad my parents had the emotional fortitude to say, stop it. No.
Because we're being unrealistic as parents if we truly expect them to be able to manage that stuff. As adults, we're doing a horrible job managing.
Yeah.
Like, we can't go through a grocery line. We can't get in the elevator. We can't be at a stoplight, right, without grabbing for our phone. You know? So how are we expecting our kids to do it? You know, I've got a big soapbox about it, but I love that you see kids come back and say they're grateful. Kids do feel grateful. And I've yet, in any of the schools I've talked to, my Sunday school class, any kid I've talked to, I've never met a kid who says, I should be spending more time on my phone.
Never, never.
They all know it's too much.
And I will tell you, I have had teenagers say to me, I'm addicted. I can't stop looking at, particularly girls with social media, because they will do whatever they can to get more likes. And then, yeah, they crave more likes, but it doesn't satisfy because it's not real. And they know it's not real, but their parents are like, well, you know, she has a fit. Here's a clue. If your child has a fit, when you tell them you're going to take something away, big red flag, there's addiction there.
Yes.
Because a child who's not addicted will go, okay, that's okay. A child who's addicted and who's there's a bad situation going on is going to throw a fit when you go to take something away. Ladies, our time is done. I could talk to you for another whole hour. I'm sure gals could listen, because I think this has been so helpful. And I hope, if nothing else, it's been encouraging to mothers in particular to say, I'm in charge of my home. I'm going to set down some rules. And this is good for my kids, and it's good for me, and I can have a better relationship with my kids. My house can be a happier place if I just start to implement some solid and healthy rules. Cassi, thank you so much. Rachel, thank you so much. I want everybody who's listening to this podcast to check out Today's Mama. Rachel, how can people learn more about what's going on at Today's Mama?
You know, you can follow along on Facebook for Today's Mama, but you can also go straight to todaysmama.com, which Mama's M-A-M-A. I know we've all got our own spelling, so.
Thanks for clarification.
Yes, connect with us there. And we're talking about a lot of this stuff, you know, all the time, especially the technology stuff lately. So we'd love to stay in touch with your listeners too.
And one of the cool thing about Today's Mama is it makes sense, and it's solid, and it's good. It's not just a lot of opinions here, there, and everywhere. It really makes sense. And a lot of the advice and the people that you have on there, it really works. So thanks for doing the great work that you're doing, both of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Friends, this is the point in the podcast when I usually answer reader questions, but today I'm going to skip that because I spent so much time talking with Rachael and Cassi. But stay with us because very soon I'm going to spend a whole podcast just answering your questions. In the meantime, friends, you can connect with me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Meg Meeker MD, or if you have a question, send it to askmeg@megmeekermd.com. Parents, I so love hearing from you. So please, even though I didn't answer questions today, keep sending me your questions. You can email me any parenting question. Nothing is off limits. I want to thank my guests, Rachael Herrscher and Cassi Reece, for being so honest and open and candid with their issues, struggling with their kids and discipline issues. And I know that you learned a lot just by listening in on the struggles they have and the obstacles that they contend with, the obstacles that I contended with when I was raising my kids at home, many of the same ones that you too struggle with your kids. Be sure to check out Rachael's awesome website, todaysmama.com. That's todaysmama, M-A-M-A.com. So let's recap my points to ponder. One, self-control is the real goal of discipline. Two, trust your instincts, particularly when it comes to what to discipline for. Number three, learn to lean on your tribe. So until next time, parents, remember, great kids are raised, not born.
Hey, this is Bobby, producer of Meg Meeker's Parenting Great Kids podcast. We hope you've enjoyed listening to episode 52, Disciplining Children. And thanks to you, Dr. Meg's parenting revolution has grown to over a million downloads. You can like Dr. Meeker on Facebook and follow her on Twitter and Instagram at Meg Meeker MD. As a reminder, go to MegMeekerMD.com and sign up for her newsletter for giveaway opportunities and updates. And don't forget to share the podcast, write us a review, and click subscribe so you won't miss an episode.